I'm David Quammen, and we're in Bozeman, Montana.
And you are a writer.
And I am a writer.
Science, travel, fiction?
I call myself a nonfiction writer with a specialty in science. I occasionally get called a nature writer or a natural history writer, and frankly, I cringe a little bit at that. In a pinch, I might call myself a science journalist, and in decades ago, I was a fiction writer. I started as a novelist. Mm-hmm. These days, I think of myself as a nonfiction writer, period, or a nonfiction writer, comma, with a special beat in science.
All right. So, David, there are three things we're truly fascinated with about writers. How they got started and their earliest influences, and how they actually conduct the regimen of their writing, and what they see the future of writing to be given changes in technology and culture.
Right.
And because I know that everybody else has covered your actual writing in great ways, so we figure we hit the areas that nobody has asked you about, probably.
Okay, so where should we start? Where I started?
Yeah, what's your earliest memories of writing and reading?
I always wrote and wanted to be a writer from a pretty young age. I mean, one of those kids, 11, 12, 13, 14, writing stories and poems and plays and things like that. And I was also interested in the natural world. So that was sort of a two-track childhood for me. On a given day, I thought, well, I'm going to be a herpetologist or an entomologist when I grow up. And another day I'd think, well, I want to be a writer. And then I had some wonderful English teachers, a couple of Jesuits. I went to a Jesuit high school. And a couple of Jesuit English teachers who really, really encouraged me and focused me and disciplined me in the way that you have to learn discipline to be a writer. And pointed me in the direction of Yale, where there was a great English department.
Yeah.
So I went to Yale because it had a great English department, and then I met the third grade teacher in my life, Robert Penn Warren, who was teaching at Yale. And I came under his broad, owlish wing. He was wonderful to me. I became sort of a friend of the family and lived with them during one summer as kind of an amanuensis and tennis partner for his kids and his wife. And about that time, I had written a draft of my first novel. And when I left him and the family that summer, he sent me essentially to his agent and his editor in New York. And that agent became my first agent. And the editor, that's a long story. Someone else, meanwhile, had sent a copy of this book to another editor. And oddly enough, the other person who helped me was Bill Buckley.
William F. Buckley?
William F. Buckley, whose politics I never shared, but whom I met through one of his proteges, young friend of mine at Yale. He took me to dinner one evening at the Buckley household, and Bill Buckley got interested, and before I knew it, he had asked for a copy of my manuscript novel. He had sent it to Alfred A. Knopf, and Alfred A. Knopf wanted to publish it. So these two men at that point, Robert Penn Warren and William F. Buckley, you could hardly find two American white males who were more different from each other, except that they were both generous and they were both very literate.
And incredibly powerful.
And they converged on helping me, this ambitious but clueless young senior at Yale, get my first novel in the pipeline at Alfred A. Knopf. Wow. So that, and it was published in the fall of 1970. So I had broken the ice. I had published my first book before I got out of graduate school, barely out of college. And then I had the opportunity to pay my dues between the first book and the second book. It turned out not to be as easy as it looked like it was going to be to become a novelist. And yeah. That's sort of another phase of the story. Then I moved to Montana. Then I went 13 years between the first book and the second book. I did all those jobs that you do: bartender, waiter, fishing guide, technical writer, ghostwriter. And in the meantime, I discovered nonfiction. Discovered that I loved it as a reader, creative, imaginative nonfiction, particularly about science. Discovered that I loved to read it, and I discovered that maybe I could write it. And I gradually turned into the kind of writer that I am now, I guess.
David, just cycling back for a second, as a child, what do you have any memories of particular writers, stories, books that really...
Yes. Things I read as a child. I wasn't a great reader.
Huh?
But I did read. I read Andre Norton, who was a science fiction writer.
Mm-hmm.
Fairly famous science fiction writer, I think. And I don't even know if Andre Norton behind that pseudonym is a he or a she. I have this vague recollection that it might be a she, but I'm not sure about that. Anyway, I read Andre Norton over and over again. I read Sherlock Holmes. I read probably a lot Edgar Allan Poe.
Mm-hmm.
I was a huge fan of Robert Service and still am.
Yeah.
So I was not a particularly thorough or sophisticated young reader. I wasn't one of those kids who at the age of 12 spends the entire summer reading Dickens.
Yeah.
Just enough to make me know that I liked it when words were put together well, and I thought that that was what I wanted to do.
Yeah. Well, listening to your story about just the encouragement of really qualified teachers, that is seems to be a secret to most of the writers we've spoken with.
I believe it. Yeah, it's hugely important. Almost makes you want to be a teacher. Although when you're 20 years old, 22, 24, and you want to be a novelist, if you're like me, then the idea of becoming an English teacher is this dreaded chasm that you don't want to fall into. Some people say, well, I want to be a writer, so I'm going to get my PhD in English and I'm going to teach for a few years. I, from early on, knew that I wanted to stay away from that tar baby. I wanted to sink or swim as a writer. I wanted to make a living doing something menial, something aggravating, something that would never tempt me to stay with it or to feel a need to do it well and to give it my heart and soul, which is why I did the other route, also a very familiar route of waiting tables and tending bar and being a fishing guide and things like that. So I never did a PhD in English. And I made sure that I did not become an English professor. Because I didn't want to be the guy who at the age of... The Wonder Boys guy, the Michael Douglas character in Wonder Boys. I didn't want to be the guy who's 45 and who has two lovely daughters in ballet school and has a half-finished novel in the desk drawer.
Yeah.
I didn't want to be that guy.
So what was it like with your first novel and first byline? All of a sudden, back comes this book, and your name is on it. Your novel is out there.
Yeah.
What was it like, the feeling? I mean, you were a young man.
It was wonderful. It was not quite, but it was almost the first thing I published. And here it is. It's a novel from Alfred A. Knopf. So it was a kick. It was thrilling. It was wonderful.
Did you do parties?
No. Oh. This was, as I said, it came out October of 1970, September or October. I think I was already in Oxford, England, doing two years of graduate work. So I was out of the country, I think, when the book was published. Nobody asked me to do a book tour. It got some reviews, including one very good one from John Leonard in the New York Times, but not many, and it didn't sell a lot of copies. So it was a typical experience for a first novel. You get a few good reviews, maybe a few bad ones, and then the book disappears and your family has it on their shelves and you move on. It gave me confidence.
Yeah.
It told me that, okay, I can do this. I can hit a big league curve. But it took me another 13 years to get any wood on the ball.
Yeah. Yeah. And what was that second one?
The second one was, 1983. It was a spy novel.
Uh-huh.
I sort of wrote my way out of obscurity by deciding, well, son of a gun, I'm gonna boil the pot. I'm gonna write a spy thriller, and maybe that'll get published. Maybe it'll even make some money. I had, in the meantime, spent some time as a ghostwriter for a fellow who thought he wanted to publish a book on the history of American technology. So I spent 2 years in a room reading about the Manhattan Project and related aspects of changes, watershed changes in American technology. And at the end of that, a fellow came to me and said, well, you're laid off. My board of directors took away my discretionary fund. This project is done, closed down, and you're gone. But you can keep the books, and anything you've written is yours. So I walked away from that with this book, half written, a nonfiction book on the history of technology, with all these books about Oppenheimer and Teller.
Ooh.
So I wrote a spy novel about Oppenheimer and Teller.
Ooh.
And it was published in 1883 by Doubleday as the Zolta configuration. Mm. Although in its original draft it was the Teller configuration, and that is something in the actual history of the development of nuclear weapons. There's something called the Teller-Ulam configuration that was the crucial idea to making the hydrogen bomb work, the thermonuclear bomb. They needed a design concept, and it was a tough nut to break. And finally, Edward Teller and Stanislaus Ulam, a Hungarian mathematician, I believe he was Hungarian, Teller was also Hungarian, came up with this concept, this configuration. And that is the Teller-Ulam configuration. My spy novel, the Zolta configuration, is about that moment in nuclear weapons history.
Wow. Sounds like fun.
It's one of the first principles of a freelance writer, as you know, is can't afford to let anything go to waste.
Yeah. Which brings us to the next big question. Your habits about writing. Mm. Do you have set habits? Do you write at particular times of the day? Do you write daily?
I am. Deplorably disciplined, I'm afraid.
No.
And that goes way back. I mean, I get up in the morning, every morning, fairly early, make coffee, come in here with a cup of coffee, a handful of prunes, sit down, start reading to get my mind awake, and then I start writing. And I do that every day until I have 1,000 pages of a book or 600 manuscript pages or whatever it is. I just keep moving along. I don't wait for inspiration to strike at 11 o'clock at night. I think when you're writing books, particularly when you're writing nonfiction books, you can't do that, you can't expect that. That's the wrong way to proceed. And this was one of the very first lessons I learned, or I taught myself, back in the fall of 1968 when I was writing that first novel. I wrote it in 68 and 69, and then it was published in 70. And I was a junior at Yale, and I said, well, I've had an experience that's rich in a context that's rich. I'm going to write a novel about this. A true piece of fiction, but with kernels of autobiography, and based on my experience, based on characters that I knew, the way most first novels are written. So I said, okay, how do you write a novel? All right, well, I'll get a bunch of yellow legal pads. I have no classes until 11 a.m. this fall term. I can get up, go to breakfast, come back, and between 9 a.m. and 11, I can write on this book. So I sat there in the fall of 1968, and between 9 and 11 every day, with a yellow legal pad and a number 2 pencil, I wrote 3 pages of first draft. And I did that for 100 days, and I hit 300 pages. And lo and behold, it was a book. It needed revising, but there it was. I had no idea whether it was possible for me to write a book, so I put my head down and said, I'm just going to do it. And by February of that year, I had finished the first and somewhat revised draft of this book that was eventually published by Knopf. So ever since then, that seemed to work. Drink coffee, sit in the chair, stay there, produce pages. If you throw them away later, fine. And you should throw some of them away, throw whole sections of them away, but get through it.
Yeah. Now, do you still use yellow pads, or do you...
No.
Have you transitioned?
I long since have transitioned. Yeah. I hung out pretty long. I was not an early adopter of the computer for word processing, but when I finally got one, I thought, okay, now I'm just going to use this for typing, second drafts and things.
Right.
And as soon as I sat down and started using it, I didn't look back, and I haven't used... I occasionally use a yellow legal pad for something, but now I'm, for a long time I've been, I am probably as terrible a typist as you could be after 40 years of making your living partly or largely from writing. I'm about as bad a typist as you could be. But the reason I'm a bad typist is because I can still type a whole lot faster than I can compose, mm-hmm. faster than I can think up good sentences.
Yeah.
So my speed in typing has never been a limiting factor.
Do you revise and edit as you write along? Or
what
do you
I do now, part? And this was not a conscious decision, this just sort of developed as my MO. Typically what I do is, when I start writing in the morning, what I actually do is start revising. I go back to I don't write 3 pages a day anymore. I'm happy to get 2. The older I've gotten, the more experienced I've gotten, the more careful I've gotten, and the slower I've gotten. That's probably a logical development. So now I'm happy if I get 2 pages a day. Generally, I spend the morning revising yesterday's 2 pages of rough draft, and then I take a break. I eat an apple, I have a handful of peanuts. Maybe I go to the post office and I come back and sit down again for another 3 hours, and then I push forward and get a new 2 pages of rough draft, and then the following morning I revise those 2 or 3 pages. So morning is usually revising yesterday's rough draft. The afternoon is creating another push into new territory with rough draft.
And do you keep journals?
Only when I travel.
Ah.
When I'm out in the field, either for an assignment, a magazine assignment, or researching a book, I carry, and over here, I don't know,
oh, yeah.
You can even photograph
yes.
this if you want, but those red binder sort of yeah. ledger books, those are my daily journal from the road, from the last 10 or 12 years, and the notebooks, the reporter's notebooks, are my moment-to-moment uh-huh. notes.
Do you start with an outline, or, you know, what's your structure?
For a book?
Mm-hmm.
The only time I ever wrote an outline for anything, this is almost literally true, as soon as I finished the outline, I was bored with the concept. I saw where it went and how it came out, and I never wrote the piece. That was just for a story. No, I don't use outlines. And yet structure is very, very important to me, and I like to think that my books are very careful. I know they're very carefully structured. They're not obviously structured. I like to think that they're very carefully and complexly and subtly structured. As I said, I studied Faulkner for years. I was obsessed with Faulkner for 10 or 12 years. I did my graduate degree on structure in 8 or 10 of Faulkner's major novels. Mm. Faulkner was my Zen master on the structure of books. And come to find out that what I learned through paying close attention to the structure of his complicated books, I used every step of the way with The Song of the Dodo. I used every step of the way with Spillover. These nonfiction books are structured in ways that I hope are organic and surprising page to page. And yet, once you have read the entire book, I hope that you feel like there is a rightness and an inevitability and maybe even sort of a niftiness or a grandeur to the structure. I hate obvious structure. I hate programmatic structure. I really love intricate, surprising, click together and deliver unexpected epiphanies structure. Let me just add something to that. Three things. I was thinking about this yesterday or the day before. Three things that matter hugely to me that you don't usually associate with nonfiction writing, nonfiction, science writing, science reporting. But three things that matter hugely to me are the structure of a work, structure of a book, pace, and rhythm, the music of the language. Very, very important to me. And it's not okay, it's not right, it's not mine unless the rhythm is there. Sometimes any of us gets edited. And occasionally an editor with good intentions will create a sentence or two that he or she feels expresses what you were saying, but has reduced 3 sentences to 1 sentence, and supposedly that's a good thing. And I look at it and I say, that's not mine. And doesn't she understand that that sentence has no music, that the rhythm is just all wrong? Ugh. So then I make a counterproposal, maybe a one-sentence version of my earlier three sentences that does have the right rhythm built into it.
So you have been there from the 60s to today writing, and you've adopted the technology. You're no doubt aware of all the changes in technology and culture. What do you think the future of writing in America is going to be like with publishing changes and machinery changes and cultural changes like Twitter?
Right.
Do you think this has any future for us?
I think there are huge changes going on, obviously.
Yes. Yes.
And over there is an iPad, and there and I use that iPad for magazine reading largely. When I travel, you know, if I go to Africa or somewhere, I can take an iPad that has 10 New Yorkers, 10 National Geographics, and 10 Atlantics on it, stored, you know, downloaded. Like, I don't want to carry 30 magazines around on my shoulder in Africa. And likewise, I carry one of these. I carry a Kindle,
which,
you know, can have 50 books on it, and has pretty good battery life.
Yeah.
This is, by the way, folks, this is not product placement. I'm getting nothing from these companies.
Yeah, no,
so there are changes like that that are enormously friendly to writing and to readers and to books and to magazines. The magazine may have to find its future almost entirely on the iPad. And I say that with trepidation. I say that with the awareness that half of my living involves working for National Geographic. I'm a contract writer for National Geographic. They call me a contributing writer. I deliver three stories a year to them. It's a very, I never foresaw writing for National Geographic, but I sort of fell in with them, and they've been very good to me. They send me to fascinating places and support me when I'm in the field in the way that few magazines can support you. So I love National Geographic.
And they're the granddaddy of magazines.
Yes. But they have an electronic version. They know how important this is. They know that the future is not in mailing heavy glossies through the U.S. Postal Service. So there are transitions happening. Kindle, e-books. And it's hard to know exactly where it's all going to shake out. Blogs, science blogs. Twitter. I am now on Twitter.
You are.
I was told, if you have a book to promote, a new book coming out, I am going to be doing a big book tour during the month of October, but 6 months ago they told me, now we hardly do book tours anymore. You need to be on Twitter, et cetera, et cetera. So I engaged with Twitter. I have a brilliant young sort of social media consultant, a coach, who I pay to help me. Have paid to help me learn how to use Twitter. And I've discovered through Twitter this network of crackerjack smart young science writers who are doing blogs, who are doing online reporting day by day, practically hour by hour, unfolding these stories in molecular biology and genetics and health sciences and other things.
So do you think that this has helped expand your readership?
I hope so. I don't know if it's helped expand my readership, but certainly people are still reading. People are still reading. Maybe they're reading more than ever before, but they're reading on screens more.
That's what research has shown, is that the amount of reading has increased in large measure because of this.
What I hope, though, that people don't lose appreciation for the book as an object, and the book as a shape. The idea that you can do in somewhere between 300 to 800 pages of sort of standard book type, you can do something that is a unit and a form and a shape that is very friendly and satisfying and memorable to people, and that can make a difference in their lives and their brains. I hope it doesn't all just become text copy with sort of no beginning and no end. That's one of the dangers, I think. I think we'll lose a lot if we lose these shapes. And it doesn't have to be paper, but it can still be a shape. A book on Kindle is still a book. It has a beginning, a middle, and end, sort of a rhythm of its own. If you're a fast reader, you read it in 3 days. If you're somebody like me, maybe, you know, you read it a half an hour a day for a month.
Yeah.
But still, it's a shape that feels right.
Yeah. That's fascinating.
I mean, this house that we're in right now, 50% of its wall surface is already about reading.
Yeah.
It's the spines of books. And I love being able to look up. It's one of the things I don't like about this gizmo.
Yeah.
I love being able to look up and see the spines of books. You know, Desmond and Moore's, Darwin, Ernst Mayr's, The Growth of Biological Thought, Mark Ridley's Evolution, Carl Zimmer's Evolution, the correspondence, the Cambridge edition of correspondence of Charles Darwin. Looking at the spines of books keeps me stimulated, keeps me remembering what it is I've read. Maybe I have a bad memory for reading, but it helps if I can look up and say, oh yeah, I remember it. Anne Applebaum's History of the Gulag. Yeah, that was a good book. Probably should reread that. Or if I need to check something, there it is. I think one of the ways to teach yourself to write is to pick a great writer and read everything that writer wrote, whether it's fiction or nonfiction, and then read it again. For me, that writer was Faulkner.
Mm-hmm.
And this was partly an exercise in the class that I first took from Robert Penn Warren. When I first got to know him, I was taking a class. And that was the idea, that you pick one great writer and you read much of what he wrote, and then you write a long paper, 60 or 70 pages, on this writer. So I did that with Faulkner, under the wing of Penn Warren. And then I kept reading Faulkner, and then I read him again. Now, it doesn't have to be Faulkner, but if you pick a great writer, and then you read everything that he or she wrote, and you read it again, you learn a couple of things. You learn that even a great writer is sometimes bad. There's maybe bad early stuff and bad late stuff. Certainly there is with Faulkner.
Yeah.
And then there's the wonderful Hartwood in the middle of the career when he's on. So you can ask yourself, why is a great writer sometimes a bad writer? What went wrong in the bad books? And I think that can be very telling.
Yeah.
The other thing you do is you read everything twice. The first time you see what he's done in these books, and the second time you start to see how he has done it much better than you saw the first time.
I think we've covered all the basic stuff we want and hope to find. You've been just a great insight.
Let me add one thing.
Please. Just,
if you were to ask me about the professional ethics and the borderlines of nonfiction writing. For instance, a question about how far can you go with being creative and still call it nonfiction? This is a real burr under my saddle. This is a real important issue to me. There's a lot of nonfiction that's published these days, maybe there always has been, that takes liberties with what I would call nonfiction. There are books that are filled, books that appear on the nonfiction bestseller list, like Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil by John Berendt, that are filled with made-up, transmogrified, altered reality that creates a better story but doesn't really correspond to what happened. The facts have been changed, the scenes have been changed to improve the drama, characters have been created as composites, all that kind of thing. And some people say, well, yeah, but it makes a better story that way. Fine, but don't call it nonfiction. Call it something else. As far as I'm concerned, when you write nonfiction, then, for instance, a quote should be a real quote. Should not be something that is your approximation of what you vaguely recall somebody having said, or your creation of what two people probably said to each other at a time when you weren't there. A quote is a datum, just the way a number coming out of a scientific paper is a datum, and should be considered sacrosanct. Now, obviously, this is a spectrum and there are gray areas. If you're creating works of nonfiction art, then by definition, a work of art is artifice, and you're altering things. Even if it's just a matter of selecting, you're selecting what's interesting and you're leaving out what's boring. Is that manipulation? Yeah, it's a form of manipulation. So I admit that this is all a spectrum, from black through shades of gray. I hate even to use that phrase, shades of gray, right now.
Right.
it's been spoiled to white, but you know what I'm you know what I'm saying. So nobody is perfect, and no work of art is absolutely factual. But I am at one end of the spectrum that says, and maybe it's partly because I write about science. Facts and numbers are sacrosanct data in science, and you have to treat them that way, or your science writing will not be respectable or respected by scientists, and then you won't get access to them. So you have to treat the facts, the numbers, as sacrosanct data. Likewise, quotes, as far as I'm concerned, are sacrosanct data. You don't invent them, you don't manipulate them, you don't improve them. Characters are data. You don't concoct them. Scenes, you capture scenes, you don't create scenes. So,
internal mental states.
Yeah, internal mental states that you can't know. Right, absolutely.
Well, so how would you define creative nonfiction? I mean, there's nonfiction, there's creative nonfiction, and then what you just described with people writing, making things up.
Well, creative nonfiction, I mean, it's almost tautological, it's almost redundant. I mean, if you're writing a nonfiction book, you're creating something. But some is more creative than others. I mean, I think creative nonfiction implies a certain artfulness. It doesn't imply liberties taken with factual material. It implies a conscious artfulness in the way factual material is put together. It implies caring a lot about structure. It implies caring a lot about rhythm, caring a lot about the music of the sentences, those things I was talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. I think that makes nonfiction creative. But inventing quotes that you didn't record or you didn't get here and get in your notebook, that's the easiest, laziest, and cheapest form of creativity. A real creative nonfiction writer is like a mosaic artist working with many, many very hard little colored tiles, each of which is unitary and solid. And those are the facts. And the way I understand writing interesting nonfiction, artful nonfiction, is that I assemble a pile of those tiles in all colors, ranging from turquoise through coral to carmine to purple, and then I put them into a shape, as though you're putting tiles on a wall. And I make a mosaic out of those little tiles. And when you step back, what you see is a Chinese dragon in eight colors with orange flame coming out of its mouth, and a saddle and a little white clown seated on the Chinese dragon. But if you get up close, all you see are these little square tiles, each of which is a fact.
Brilliant. Wow. Truly. Very nice. David, you've just been
amazing.
Wonderful.
Amazing.
Well,
thank you.
Well, it's been fun talking with you, sharing these things. I'm glad you're interested.
Oh, we and lots of people.